Abel.
Mucho gusto.
María Teresa. ¿Tú no?
Elika.
Evo.
Evo.
Abel, ya. En Worcester, Massachusetts.
Okay.
Fairbanks Church.
Okay.
Sí. España.
También.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. He will say it to English. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Hablar en español. En ambos idiomas. Pero tú lo vas a hacer las que.
Sí. Para ayudar. Te aprecio un montón.
Não, vou fazer o seguinte, deixa a parte de vocês que não está ensaiando. Depois eu toco mais. Eu vou, logo que eu fizer a minha apresentação, eu já faço.
Buenas noches y bienvenidos a todos. Good evening and welcome to Andover Newton Theological School. Este es nuestro primer evento bilingüe y primeramente en español y portugués que tenemos, que ofrecemos en nuestra escuela. Así que les pedimos paciencia y coordinación. Estamos entregados de corazón a esta empresa. Así que le damos una cordial bienvenida y esperamos que sea una buena noche para todos y nuestra de enriquecimiento para todos. So good evening and welcome. This is Andover Newton's first bilingual presentation. I hope the first of many. So we ask of you that you be patient with the translations and that you cooperate, and in the hopes that this will be a great event for all of us gathered, that we will learn a lot from each other. El nombre del evento es la Iglesia Hispana, el pasado, presente y el futuro ahora soy yo la que estoy confundida. ¿Cómo se dice?
Adoración.
De la adoración.
Adoración.
El culto y la adoración.
Adoración.
Latina en Estados Unidos. Y tenemos el honor de tener como panelistas a el reverendo doctor Abel Bill Capoma. La ministra Elibet Méndez, que también es estudiante de Andover Newton Theological School, y el reverendo José Barte de Sousa, de Worcester, que también es exalumno de Andover Newton Theological School. We are really grateful to have as our panelists in tonight's presentation with the title The Latino or Hispanic Church, Past, Present, and Future of Latino Worship in America, to have the Reverend Dr. Abel Bill Capoma, Minister Elibet Méndez Angulo, who's a current student at Andover Newton Theological School, and Reverend Rosa Barte de Souza from Worcester, who is an alumnus of Andover Newton. Cada panelista va a presentar unos 15 minutos, va a dar su contexto de ministerio, dónde está establecido, cuánto tiempo lleva en su iglesia, qué clase de proyectos ha llevado a cabo su iglesia y cómo se ha mantenido en su contexto, además de sus observaciones sobre el tema a discutir hoy. Y cada presentación poco a poco se va a ir traduciendo al inglés también. Each panelist will give a 15-minute, approximately, a presentation, which will include a presentation of their own ministerial context, how long they have been there, what type of projects they have undertaken in that context, and other wisdom that they can offer from their own context to the question that we are dealing with tonight. And they will be translated as they speak, as they go along. Vamos a abrir la sala para preguntas cuando terminemos todas las presentaciones y para tener una conversación rica entre todos nosotros. We will open for questions at the end of all the panelists' presentations for hopefully a lengthy segment of questions and answers. Estamos complacidos en que la oficina de admisiones de Andover Newton Theological School del seminario es la que ofrece este programa esta noche. Es el primer programa en dos que tenemos este mes, honrando el legado de Orlando Costas en Andover Newton. This is the first of two programs, this one sponsored by the admissions office at Andover Newton. And it is the first of two programs honoring the legacy of Orlando Costas at Andover Newton. La próxima semana, en una semana de esta noche, martes a las 6:15, tenemos la charla Orlando y Rose Costas Lecture, que la va a presentar el distinguido académico Orlando Espín de la Universidad de San Diego. Va a venir a hablarnos, y este es el tema de su charla. ¿Quién es humano, tradición y el centro subversivo de la cristiandad? Who is human, tradition, and the subversive center of Christianity? So, this is the first Costas event for this year, and the second one will be a week from tonight, right here at 6:15, which is the Orlando and Rose Costas lecture given by Orlando Espín from the University of San Diego. That is always a fantastic time, an enriching time, and so I hope we see a lot of you again next week. So please join us again for that. Espero que muchos puedan regresar la semana próxima para esta charla. Bien, unas palabras cortas sobre el programa Costas en Andover Newton y nuestro legado con las comunidades hispanas. Hemos tenido durante muchas décadas una relación bastante extensa y comprometida con las comunidades hispanas del área de Boston y de Nueva York, New Jersey y otras áreas. En los últimos, 15, 10 años, parte de esa relación pues ha caído un poco, y estamos muy interesados y muy comprometidos en restablecer esos lazos y ver cómo nuestro seminario puede servirle a la comunidad hispana en Massachusetts y en el área de Nueva Inglaterra. Andover Newton has a rich history and legacy of a tight commitment and a deep commitment to Hispanic churches in the Massachusetts and New England area for many decades. And for the past 10 years or so, some of those relationships have weakened, but we are now revisiting that and renewing our commitment to the Hispanic churches in Massachusetts and the New England area. And so we are really thankful for you and thankful for our students, and also interested in what conversations like this can offer us to see what's the role of a seminary in theological education for Hispanic ministries. Bueno, vamos a comenzar primero con una presentación y oración que nos va a dirigir nuestra estudiante Carla, y quizá ella nos pueda hablar un poco más de lo que va a hacer. Y luego de su oración, presentación, donde todos vamos a participar, entonces comenzaremos con el panel. Nuevamente, bienvenidos, y espero que disfrutemos de nuestra noche. We will begin first with a presentation / prayer invocation for our gathering today that our student Carla is going to do for us, and she will speak a little bit more about what we'll be doing. And then after her participation and our participation, we will begin with the panel. Okay, thank you.
Karsten will be, I think, God for Karsten, who is helping me out with the guitar. Vou falar em português, porque aqui a coisa é bilíngue. Então, vamos falar em português. Ela falou em espanhol, agora falo eu em português. Boa noite.
Boa noite.
Ai, pode ser melhor. Boa noite.
Boa noite. Boa noite.
I like that. Ok. O que nós vamos cantar é uma música chamada Amazing Grace. What we're going to sing is a song called Amazing Grace. Eu vou começar cantando devagar e depois que eu tocar a flautinha, todos nós vamos cantar juntos, e cada um em sua língua. Quem aqui fala espanhol? Who speaks Spanish? Who speaks Portuguese? Okay. Who speaks another language? Good. How many of you know Amazing Grace in your own language? Oh, that's good. So what we're going to do, nós vamos ter gostinho de Pentecostes. We are going to have a taste of Pentecost. What we're going to do, and we're going to sing it in a rhythm, in a Brazilian rhythm called baião, which is from the Northeast. It goes. But in the beginning, I'm going to be a little slow. But whenever I finish playing this, you can sing, because it's nothing better than Amazing Grace, right? Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Second verse in your language. Was grace that taught to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How great. Grace once more. Muito obrigada por essa noite. Obrigada por essa interação entre povos que nós temos aqui. Thank you, Father, for this interaction. Thank you, Mother, for this interaction of groups of all kinds of nations, of kinds of language. It's so good to be together. Be with us. Seja com a gente. In your name we pray. En su nombre nos oramos. Amén.
Amén. Amén.
Gracias, Carla. Mucho grado. Well, we will start tonight with Pastor Abel, and Roberto Ochoa is going to be translating for him. So I'm going to step aside.
Buenas noches a todos ustedes. Es un gozo estar aquí en mi alma mater después de 20 años.
Good evening to everybody. Can you hear me? It's a pleasure to be here and a joy, especially after 20 years
in my alma mater.
His alma mater.
I'm from Peru. Soy de Perú y hice estudios en Costa Rica, el Perú, Estados Unidos, y trabajé también en Puerto Rico.
He's from Peru and he studied in Costa Rica,
Peru,
Estados Unidos, United States.
Y trabajé en Puerto Rico.
And he worked in Puerto Rico.
Visitando la isla de la República Dominicana.
Including the island, the country of Dominican Republic.
Y Dios me dio el privilegio de viajar por Sur, Centroamérica y casi muchos estados de Estados Unidos.
I've had the privilege to be able to tour all of Central America, South America, and all over the United States, all over the Americas.
Cuando la señorita Robin me invitó para traerles acá, me dijo que era un panel sobre la adoración a Dios.
When I was invited to preach by Miss Robinson,
yeah.
he was understanding it was a panel on the adoration of
worship to God.
Worship of God.
Mm-hmm. Este tema me impactó bastante.
This theme really impacted me.
Entonces he dividido en tres partes mi pequeña exposición.
His various positions.
Yeah. Y el versículo base para mi exposición está en Juan 4, del 23 al 24.
The main verse of his, he's going to start with is Gospel of John, chapter
4.
Chapter 4.
23 al 24.
Verses 23 to 24.
Voy a leerlo. Dice, Jesús dijo así, pero la hora viene y ahora es cuando los verdaderos adoradores adorarán al Padre en espíritu y en verdad.
Okay. Do you have the scripture in English?
No, in English.
Okay.
Yeah,
you can... Yeah. Can you read English, please?
Okay, thank you. Sorry about this. John chapter 4, verses 23 to 24. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking each such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth.
Entonces me puse a pensar... ¿Cómo era en el Antiguo Testamento la adoración a Dios? ¿Qué es lo que dijo Cristo? ¿Y qué es lo que hay en la iglesia hoy en día?
Okay, so I started to think how we worship nowadays was meant out of the Bible.
Yeah, how was the worship in the Old Testament? What Jesus said and what about the Christ today in the church.
What he said.
Yeah. Okay. The worship of God in the Eden was 100% spiritually. I'm not going to speak in Spanish, you translate that. En el huerto de Edén había una comunicación entre el creador y su criatura.
In the word, there was that creation, the communication of the creator and of the creature.
Yeah. Había la vida espiritual 100%.
There was that spirit of life 100%.
Yeah. Eran los
Las criaturas de Dios eran puros, inocentes, santos, limpios de conciencia.
The creatures of God were clean, pure, of pure spirit.
Yeah. No había pecado, no so sin error. Yeah. Pero al caer el hombre en pecado,
but then humanity, then the human one sinned.
Yeah. El hombre quedó alma viviente y cuerpo, pero su espíritu murió.
Even though the human remained carnally in body, the spirit had died.
Yeah. Porque Dios dice creó el alma viviente y su cuerpo, pero su espíritu, hubo una ruptura entre el hombre y Dios.
There was a rupture between God and humanity.
Entonces, el hombre perdió su relación espiritual con Dios porque Dios es espíritu.
And therefore, humanity lost their relationship with God because they lost the spirit, and God is spirit.
Voy a darles poquito ejemplos de la adoración de Noé a Dios. Dice que Noé era un hombre justo, perfecto, y halló gracia ante los ojos de Dios.
Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about the example of Noah, who was was good in God's sight.
Was perfect, and he found grace in the eyes of God.
He found grace in the eyes of God.
Y él hizo un altar de todos los animales limpios y adoró a Dios después del diluvio.
He did an altar of all the clean people to worship God, to honor God after the flood.
No, clean animals.
Clean animals.
Yeah. Sí. Abraham also. Abraham me llamó la atención porque cada vez que salió de Ur y hacía su campamento, edificaba un altar y adoraba a Dios.
And Abraham is of interest to me because every time he set up a tent, he made sure he set up a tent to honor and worship God.
Y fue llamado amigo de Dios, Abraham.
Abraham was amigo?
Yeah.
Abraham was a friend of God.
No, he was called friend of God.
He was called a friend of God.
Okay. Moisés construyó el arca, el tabernáculo en medio del pueblo de Israel en el desierto.
And Moses created the Ark of the Covenant in a temple.
No, tabernáculo.
Tabernacle.
In the middle of his people.
In the middle of his people.
Dios quería estar presente con su pueblo.
God wanted to be present with God's people.
Hablaba con Moisés.
He spoke to Moses.
Con Moisés al pueblo.
And Moses spoke to the community, to the faithful, to the flock.
Pero la gente tenía que acercarse a Dios.
But the people had to get near to God.
Cumpliendo las exigencias de Dios.
Completing the commandments or the direction of God.
Tenía que ser santo, sin pecado.
They had to be holy without sin.
Arrepentido, limpio.
Repentant, clean.
Era una adoración completamente espiritual.
So this was a worship completely spiritual.
Yeah. En el tiempo de David y Salomón,
in the time of David and Solomon,
en el templo se instaló el coro para alabar a Dios.
And in the temple was the coro?
Coros. Coro. Choir.
Choir, okay.
Yeah.
To honor God.
Well, entonces, los instrumentos que Salomón mandó construir era el arpa.
The instruments that Solomon
salterios, had, etcétera, para el culto a
Jehová. The instruments that Solomon had created were the harps and the.
Yeah. Pero en la adoración, toda persona que adoraba a Dios tenía un cambio total en su vida.
But those, and so at the actual type of worship, there was a change of people in their lives.
Por ejemplo, Jacob, después de pelear con Dios, Dios le cambió el nombre de Jacob a Israel y vino a ser el padre de los israelitas.
For instance, Jacob, when he wrestled with God, you know, Jacob's name was changed to Israel.
Y él dejó de ser un manipulador, un engañador, un usurpador.
He ended being a manipulator, a liar, a deceitful, deceptive.
O sea, el contacto con Dios hace una transformación total en el individuo.
So the contact with God just causes a transformation with the individual, within the individual.
Moisés también, cuando recibió la zarca del testimonio, su rostro era iluminado y tenía que taparse con un velo para que la gente hablara con él.
So, for instance, when Moses was presented, there was a change also. He was overcome by the brilliance.
Yeah, splendor.
The splendor of God, and he had to cover his eyes.
Yeah.
To be able to communicate to the people.
Isaías lo mismo. Él, cuando escuchó, vio en la revelación el trono de Dios, y dice, uy, yo voy a morir porque he visto al Dios.
Isaías also, when he saw the throne of God, also was so brilliant that he thought he was going to die because it was so bright.
Y al querubín le puso un carbón en la lengua y lo purificó, lo santificó, lo limpió, lo perdonó. El serafín. Came and they cleaned his stone. Isaiah. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I didn't.
And the sign was, Isaiah was clean. Sí, completely clean. Yeah. Pure.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm just like okay, because I want to understand too. So, okay, So Isaiah's tongue was touched and cleansed.
It was clean.
Touched and cleansed.
Yeah. Y su pecado fue perdonado.
And his sin was forgiven.
Yeah. Ahora. En conclusión, esta parte es que se nota que todo aquel que se acerca y adora a Dios sufre una transformación total de su vida.
In conclusion, to within the Old Testament, is that anyone that comes in contact with God, their life becomes transformed and they change.
Aplicando a nuestra vida hoy, entonces nuestra vida debe ser una vida santa en la familia.
And by applying that today into our lives should be holy within our families.
Nuestros amigos, los vecinos, el trabajo, la escuela, en todo lugar. Debemos reflejar el cambio que Dios ha hecho en nuestra vida.
We should be a reflection of the changes that God provides us in our lives. May that be in our jobs, may it be at school, may it be anywhere. It should be manifested.
Okay. Now, sobre Cristo. Cristo dijo tres cosas muy importantes sobre la adoración.
And Christ came about. Now, regarding Christ, Christ said three really important things about worship.
Dice, el verdadero adorador debe adorar al Padre en espíritu y en verdad.
And the true believer should be able to worship the God in truth and in spirit.
A believer will worship, the person who worship God.
The person that worships God,
yeah, should, debe adorar en espíritu y en verdad.
Should do it in spirit and truth.
Porque tales adoradores buscan que lo adoren. Dios está buscando esos adoradores.
God is looking for that type of worship, worshipers.
Dios es espíritu. Y los que adoran en espíritu deben adorar en espíritu y en verdad.
So God being of spirit, the worshipper should worship in spirit and truth.
Ahora, ¿qué es adoración en espíritu?
What is worship and spirit?
Bueno, la adoración en espíritu empezó en el Edén.
The worship of
donde había pureza, santidad, inocencia, sin pecado.
Usted dijo Edén, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So the actual worship began in Eden, where there was purity and
inocencia, santidad, no había pecado.
Holy, there was no, which was holy and there was no sin.
Pero al morir el hombre espiritualmente,
but the humanity who died spiritually,
el hombre vino a ser familia del diablo, ya no de Dios.
Okay, the man then came from the devil.
Yeah.
And no longer of God.
Yeah. Porque Jesús dice lo que aquí en Juan, dice lo que ha nacido de la carne, carne es; lo que ha nacido del espíritu, espíritu es.
Okay, like Christ said in John, that which was born of the flesh is flesh, and that born of the spirit is spirit.
Entonces, de acuerdo a Cristo, el individuo tiene que nacer de nuevo.
And so according to Christ, the individual has to be born again.
Pero nacer en espíritu.
And be reborn spiritually.
Dios es espíritu, el hombre nace en espíritu, y hay una conexión entre Dios espíritu y el espíritu del hombre.
So since God is a spirit, and being reborn and by being reborn spiritually, humanity, it comes together spiritually.
Ahora, la adoración en verdad debe tener un tremendo contenido bíblico.
So true worship should really follow the content of Scripture.
Debe basarse en la persona de Cristo.
It should begin, but ¿qué?
Debe basarse en la persona de Cristo.
It should be basad. Grounded. Okay, thank you. Should be grounded in the Spirit of Christ.
Jesús ya sentenció. Yo soy el camino, la verdad y la vida.
As Jesus said, as Christ said, I am the truth, the way, and the light.
Nadie viene al Padre sino por mí.
No one comes to God without coming through me.
En conclusión, entonces, el verdadero adorador,
in conclusion, then, the true believer
tiene que haber nacido en el Espíritu,
needs to be born of the Spirit,
en la familia de Dios,
in the family of God,
y tener la verdad central, que es Cristo,
and to have that spiritual focus, which is Christ.
Todo otro argumento de adoración que la gente llame, si no está centrada en Cristo, es secundario.
Everything else, if it's not focused on Christ, the worship, anything in worship that is not focused on Christ is secondary.
Hay mucha equivocación en las iglesias y en la comunidad y en el mundo.
There's a lot of mistaken notions within.
Yo adoro a Dios con sinceridad, dice mucha gente.
People will say, I worship God sincerely.
Pero hay mucha gente equivocada, sinceramente.
But there are people that
se arrodillan, never adoran a ídolos.
They seem
que no
to,
tienen vida.
Since they tend to kneel down before idols which have no life.
Como dice el Salmo 115, etc.
Like Psalm 116 says.
La otro punto es que dice Jesús,
the other point
el Padre
said,
tales adoradores busca que lo adoren. O sea, Dios está buscando,
God is looking,
por verdaderos adoradores.
For the true believers.
Ahora, la pregunta es, ¿dónde están esos adoradores?
Where are the believers? Where are the worshipers?
¿Dónde están?
Where are they?
Dios nos creó a nosotros para adorar a Dios.
God created us to worship God.
Pero Él está buscando verdaderos adoradores.
But God is looking for those true worshipers, those true believers.
La pregunta es, si vamos a la casa de Dios un domingo,
the question is, if we go to the house of God on a Sunday,
preguntémonos a nosotros mismos,
we ask ourselves,
¿realmente estoy adorando a Dios en espíritu y en verdad?
Are we really worshiping God in spirit and truth?
¿Dios encontrará verdaderos adoradores en cada culto los domingos?
God can discover true believers in all worships on all Sundays.
Sí, humanamente no estamos capacitados para adorar a Dios como Él quiere.
Truly, we are not equipped to be able to worship God completely as God wants us to.
Pero aceptando el altar de Cristo, el altar de la cruz de Cristo,
by accepting the altar of Christ, of Jesus, the cross of Christ,
entonces podemos adorarle a Él.
Then we can worship God.
Mi experiencia personal.
My personal experience.
Hay una pregunta ¿vamos a la casa de Dios preparados espiritualmente?
I have a question. Are we going to worship spiritually?
Porque hay un concepto infantil que dice la gente, muchos cristianos, dice, yo voy a la casa de Dios, leo la palabra, oro, canto himnos, escucho el sermón, doy mis ofrendas, con eso es suficiente y adoré a Dios.
Okay, let's try it again.
Many people say, no, I go to the house of God, I read the Bible, I pray, I sing, I listen to the sermon, I give my offering, this is sufficient. I worship God. ¿No? Otros dicen, yo voy a la iglesia los domingos, doy mi diezmo, con eso cumplí con el Señor.
And so, and others will say that I go to God and I give my tithing and I've done my duty.
Este es un error terrible.
This is a terrible error.
Es muy infantil.
Infantil. Childish. This is very childish.
Sí. El hecho de ir al templo, participar en el culto, dar los diezmos, ya cumplí con el Señor, dice mucha gente.
The thing that you go to church, just go to church, and then you just do your tithing, and that's all you need to do.
Ahora, la pregunta es, ¿Dios estará encontrando verdaderos adoradores en el templo?
And the question is God finding true believers in that church?
Esa es una buena pregunta.
That's a good question.
¿Cuántos verdaderos adoradores encontrará Dios en cada culto?
How many true believers can be found in worship?
Nosotros, creyentes de muchos años,
us, we who are believers of many years,
debemos de pensar,
to think,
we have to think, tenemos que crecer,
we have to grow,
tenemos que madurar,
we have to mature,
tenemos que internalizar,
we have to internalize,
tenemos que conceptualizar,
we have to conceptualize,
y tenemos que hacernos esta pregunta.
We need to ask this question.
¿Estoy realmente preparado espiritualmente para adorar a Dios en espíritu y en verdad?
Am I really prepared to worship God in spirit and truth?
Sí. Well, muchos quizás confunden con cantar y alabar al Señor.
Many may confuse the singing and the praise of God.
Hoy en día, en las iglesias,
nowadays in churches,
hay una mezcla de muchos himnos, himnologías pasadas del siglo después de la Reforma, siglo XIX, siglo XX, ahora siglo XXI.
Now there's a lot of mixtures of hymns from the past, from the beginning, before the Reformation, the 19th century, the 20th century.
Después de la Reforma vino los las reformadores, crearon diferentes denominaciones y trajeron, vinieron por persecución o por misiones a América Latina, el Caribe, con músicas de buena teología, con órgano, con piano, y eso nos sembraron a nosotros América Latina y el Caribe.
And after the Reformation and various denominations all came, and missionaries came to the Americas bringing their hymns of theology from their cultures and mixing it with the Americas, within the Americas.
Pero cuando vinieron las iglesias pentecostales, invadieron muchas iglesias y con nuevos himnos.
When the Pentecostals came from churches, they came with many hymns.
Con nuevos ritmos.
With new rhythms.
Nuevos instrumentos.
New instruments.
Más alegres.
Happier.
Más movidos. Más emocionales.
More emotional.
Más entusiastas.
Much more enthusiastic.
Más gozosas. Más rítmicas.
Más rítmicas. Much more rhythm.
Entonces, muchos autores de himnos, especialmente basándose en los salmos, compusieron bonitos himnos, nuevo ritmo en toda América Latina, y influyeron en los cánticos y alabanzas en los templos.
And so the hymns, many that were authored and based on psalms and beautiful music, was brought in and influence new music and blended music in the Americas.
Sin embargo, hay países y hay iglesias donde no aceptan el 100% esta influencia.
And there are churches that just do not accept this influence 100%.
How many minutes? Fine, okay. Gracias. Muchos de esas iglesias prefieren sus himnos o ritmos autóctonos o nativos en el Caribe, Centro y Sudamérica.
And many prefer to, these hymns based on their own cultures, within the indigenous cultures. Within
autóctonos, native, nativos.
Native.
Yeah.
Sí, native, indigenous.
Sí, entonces hay una mezcla de los nuevos himnos, nuevos ritmos, con sus ritmos autóctonos. Por ejemplo, los himnos rancheros. El Caribe tiene muchos himnos con el jibarito. Y cantan himnos. En Sudamérica, los nativos de los Andes, Bolivia, Perú, Ecuador, los países de Argentina, Chile, tienen sus propios ritmos. Entonces, a veces hay una mezcla entre los himnos modernos y los himnos y melodías autóctonas.
So I'm going to paraphrase this, because that the hymns that and the music that came in have heavily influenced from the indigenous, depending on mixtures, like for instance the rancheros in Mexico or the rhythm in the Caribbean, the Incas, the indigenous music in South America, and this caused a blend. Mm-hmm. A blend that is preferred by the communities of the Americas.
Bueno, lo interesante es que hoy en día en las iglesias hay otro ritmo, es más alegre, más emocional, y hay instrumentos musicales, electrónicos, grupos de cantantes, etc. Muchas veces los ritmos seculares también influyen en la adoración en las iglesias.
So even today, I mean, today in modern worship, you can see the influences of the many types of music within our church music, our hymns, even to a point that new instruments are coming in, even circular music is beginning to influence our worship of praise.
Okay. My conclusion is, considering the worship in Old Testament, considering what Jesus said, and also if you take a note about the Revelation, how the elders, 24 elders, the angels, and the worship God, I make this conclusion. La adoración a Dios es totalmente espiritual.
The conclusion I've come is that worship of God is totally spiritual.
Dios es espíritu, los que hemos nacido en espíritu. De nuevo en espíritu debemos adorarle en espíritu.
And God being spirit, those of us that are born again spiritually should worship spiritually.
Acomodando lo espiritual a lo espiritual.
And you know, accommodating the spirit with the spirit.
Segundo, la adoración a Dios debe ser en verdad.
Secondly, the worship of God should be truth.
Adorar al Padre en verdad es basarse en la persona de Cristo.
To be able to worship God in truth is to do that in the sense of
porque él es la verdad.
Because Christ is the truth.
Ya lo dijo. Yo soy el camino, la verdad y la vida. Nadie viene al Padre sino por mí.
As Jesus said, I'm the truth, the way, and the light, and no one comes to God except through me.
Ahora, el creyente que quiere adorar a Dios y al Cordero en espíritu.
The believer that wants to worship God in spirit.
Ya. Debe prepararse espiritualmente.
To prepare them spiritually. To prepare themselves spiritually.
Debe confesar.
They should confess.
Pedir perdón a Dios.
Ask forgiveness of God.
Arrepentirse genuinamente.
To repent themselves.
Ser transparente.
Be transparent.
No hipócrita.
Don't be hypocritical. Not being hypocritical.
Debe recordar que para estar en la presencia de Dios es un asunto muy serio.
So to present yourselves in the presence of God is something serious.
Dios es santo, santo, santo.
God is holy, holy, holy.
Puro, no hay pecado.
Pure without sin.
Por tanto, el que adora debe ir con humildad.
And that who comes to worship should come
with humility. Rendirse a Dios completamente. Rendirse a Dios completamente.
Render themselves to God completely.
100%.
100%.
Como dice Romanos 12:1.
Like Romans 12:1 says.
Como sacrificio vivo.
As sacrifice we live.
Santo.
Holy.
Y agradable a Dios.
And agradable. Pleasing to God.
Humanamente, nosotros no estamos capacitados para adorar a Dios como Él es digno. Ya termino.
Okay, humanly.
Pero sí, la gracia de Jesús nos permite adorar a Dios.
Humanly, it's not possible to worship God completely if it wasn't for the grace of Christ that allows us to do so.
Las alabanzas y cánticos al Señor.
The praises and songs to God.
Debe ser alegre, entusiasta, gozosa.
To be happy, enthusiastic, joyous.
Variable. Pero cantar por cantar.
But to sing, to sing.
Alabar por alabar.
To praise, to praise.
No es adorar a Dios.
It's not really worshiping
God. Ese es mi concepto. Gracias.
Thank you. Gracias.
Yeah, thank you.
Gracias, Pastor Abel. Gracias. Y continuamos con Eli.
Gracias. Bueno, yo me llamo Elivet Méndez Angulo. Yo soy estudiante aquí en Andover Newton Theological School. A la vez que he sido estudiante aquí, también soy ministro de discipulado en una iglesia llamada Manantial de Gracia en New Britain, Connecticut. Bueno, acabando de mudarse a West Hartford, Connecticut. Somos una iglesia UCC, de la Iglesia Unida de Cristo, y yo he sido participante en esa iglesia ya desde ya más de 8 años. En mi tiempo ahí he sido también, soy recipiente de una beca de Héctor López, nombrada por un gran y de Orlando Costa Scholar también aquí en esta universidad. También soy miembro de la junta de directiva de Franklinton Center at Brooks. My name is Elivette Méndez Angulo, I go by Ellie. I am a member or a student here at Andover Newton Theological School. In my time here, I have been a recipient of the Hector Lopez Scholarship, which is a UCC scholarship, also of the Orlando Costa Scholars. I am a member of the Board of Trustees for the Franklinton Center at Brooks, a place that I love very, very much. And also, I am Minister of Discipleship in my local congregation. I've been doing that for about 8 years. Let me start with a word that came to me. In Spanish, it says in Revelations 4, verse 11, Señor, eres digno de recibir la gloria, la honra y el poder, porque tú creaste el universo. Lo que existe, existe porque tú quisiste crearlo. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, for thy pleasure they are and were created. That's kind of my founding theology. Mm-hmm. My only job in life is to worship God. Esa es mi teología. Mi única necesidad, lo único que yo tengo adentro de mí es la necesidad de adorar y alabar a Dios. A un Dios que en realidad se lo merece todo y yo soy poca cosa para tratar de no hacerlo. I am very grateful to be able to do that, to worship God in that way, knowing that I am completely unworthy. I have nothing in me that is deserving of even worshiping God, but He still is worthy of the little bit of me that has enough grace left inside of it to do that. Now, I was asked a couple of questions, so I'm going to kind of stick to my questions that I was given. Let's see if I can find my responses. A mí me dieron unas ciertas preguntas, y yo voy a tratar de mantenerme en estas preguntas. Quizás me vaya un poco, pero por favor, tengan paciencia. Please be patient with me. La primera pregunta que me hicieron fue, I have to start in English because the questions were written in English, and it's better for me to translate in the opposite direction. So the question that I was first asked was to give a description of my ministerial role in this community. Como ministro del discipulado en mi iglesia, una de las cosas que es parte de mi provenza es enseñar por ejemplo. To teach by example is one of the things that I would say is my greatest responsibility in my church. And what I have found is that children and adults learn by doing and learn by seeing and learn by trying it out a little bit. Nosotros aprendemos muchas veces mirando, intentando y después haciendo con atrevimiento cuando lleguemos a ese punto. So, some of the things that have come up in our church are pictures that we draw with children. Algunas de las cosas que han surgido en nuestra iglesia son fotos y dibujos que hacemos con los niños. Muchas veces nosotros le enseñamos a los niños historia y hacemos dibujos y los pegamos en las paredes. Oftentimes we draw these things with the children in Bible study and we post them on the walls. And what happens is that the adults will often say, I don't quite understand what that picture is. Los adultos responden con que en realidad no entienden lo que son esos dibujos. Not because the child is not artistically gifted. No porque el niño no sabe dibujar, but rather because the adult is disconnected somehow from the stories that the children are trying to tell. Más porque los niños están desconectados de las historias que los adultos están desconectados de las historias que los niños están tratando de enseñar. Eso ha creado una conciencia de algo que no habíamos pensado anteriormente. That's led to the realization of some things that we had never thought of before. Namely that the adults that come to church today are not necessarily the adults that came to church 20 years ago. Básicamente, los adultos que vienen a la iglesia hoy en día muchas veces no son como los adultos que llegaron a la iglesia hace 20 años atrás. Eso quiere decir, that means, the adults that come to church today oftentimes are unchurched. Muchas veces estos son adultos que llegan a la iglesia que no han tenido concepto espiritual de lo que es ser parte de una iglesia. Eso quiere decir que nosotros como iglesia hemos tenido que responder diferentemente. We as a church have had to have a unique response to that problem because it's a new experience for us. For example, how do you respond to the question of do those Reyes Magos, los Reyes Magos, eso es bíblico?
Yeah.
You know, how do you respond to the question of the wise men? Is that biblical? That might sound like a strange question to come up in a church with people who've been raised in the church, but it's not such a strange concept with people who have been unchurched. Another example. Cuando uno empieza a pensar de esa misma dilema de los Reyes Magos en el concepto latinoamericano, en donde los magos son cosas negativas y tienen conceptos que son medio
peligroso.
When you think of the wise men or the magi in the context of Latin America, in the context of the Caribbean, where the magi has a negative connotation to it, it's not surprising that you would get a question like that. La pregunta entonces tiene más sentido. Because we've been taught as a community that magic is something that's not of God. Nos han enseñado que la magia es algo que no viene de Dios. So el concepto de esa pregunta entonces cambia. So then the concept of that question changes slightly. So how do you respond to that moment then that starts the story of the wise men? ¿Cómo uno responde a la pregunta que en realidad viene siendo el principio de la historia de los Reyes Magos? For example, going back to the wise men, regresando a los Reyes Magos. When I teach a Bible class around the wise men and, you know, these wise beings that came and met Jesus, I always tell the children that there were three gifts, but they weren't gifts for us, they were gifts for Jesus, right? Los Reyes Magos trajeron tres regalos, pero los regalos no fueron para nosotros, los regalos fueron para el niñito Jesús. Question, con una preguntita, porque en realidad ese concepto es real o es algo interesante e intrigante. Is that a real reality or is that just a concept that's intriguing? With children, when you read the story, the reality is that they often pick up on a moment that we adults forget or neglect, which is the moment when the wise men, having this burden of these beautiful gifts that they carried, instead of running over to the baby Jesus with the gifts, bow down and worship God. Worship this creation. Worship the baby that just came up. En realidad, con los niños, ellos ven cosas de una perspectiva que nosotros a veces no hemos notado, que es, los niños cuando miran esa historia, muchas veces son los que me dicen, pero eso no fue, los regalos no fueron la cosa importante. Los regalos fueron como que obsequio después. Lo importante fue cuando llegaron y se tiraron de cara y adoraron a Dios. So entonces, what is worship? So then, what is worship? When we look at it from a children's perspective, and that's the interest that I have, it changes a little bit. Worship is the first gift that Jesus received. Jesus did not receive gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Jesus received worship. So then, how do you teach that to the children when the adults don't quite get it yet? ¿Cómo uno llega al punto de poder enseñarle eso a los adultos cuando los adultos son los que no han llegado al punto que entienden ese concepto todavía? La tercera pregunta que me preguntaron fue, what is the biggest challenges faced by a community? ¿Cuáles son los dilemas más provocantes que la comunidad está mirando hoy en día? Bueno, mi respuesta ha sido bien simple. My response has been quite simple. It's language. But not the language we speak necessarily. No la lengua que nosotros hablamos necesariamente. Explicando, culturalmente, nuestro entendimiento de las palabras es diferente. Explaining it this way. Culturally, language is not just the words that you use, it's also the context in which you use it. Ethnically, racially, racialmente, es diferente. But there's a third little level that we quite often forget. Hay una tercera parte que muchas veces se nos olvida, y es age. La lengua de la edad, the language of age. Because the things that I learn at my age are not the things that my mother learned at my age. We're now living in a different reality. En español, las cosas que yo he aprendido a mi edad no son las mismas cosas que aprendió mi mamá a la edad que yo tengo hoy en día. No pueden ser, no estamos viviendo la misma realidad. Y entonces, tradición religiosa, religious tradition, backgrounds, las cosas que nos han pasado en el pasado, our inherited religious knowledge versus our experiences. Pero cómo uno puede, and here I get confusing because I don't know how to say all of those words in Spanish, and I don't know how to say some of them in English. How do we respond to these things in lieu of our inherited religious knowledge versus our experiences. Because it's not necessarily the things that I know, but sometimes it's also the things that I have learned without ever knowing it. The things that I've picked up on from my parents that maybe I don't understand the concept of. You know, the words that we pick up on, Magi is one of them. Magi and its association with witchcraft and voodoo and all of those connotations that we associate with that word, maybe if we didn't understand the language the same way, if I didn't understand language the same way as my mother did, I might never have gotten to the point where I understood what the question or the problem around the Magi was, but I understood it differently. Next, I was asked about...
Eso que acabas de decir, explícalo en español.
Ay, ¿cómo lo explico?
Mija, tu problema.
I think I've just been told to translate it, and I'm having a hard time. Did I have to translate it to Spanish or to English?
To Spanish.
To Spanish. Okay, okay, I'm sorry. La tradición religiosa es un concepto que es difícil explicarla. ¿Cómo hemos llegado a esos puntos? Nuestra herencia, nuestro entendimiento que hemos heredado religiosamente no es necesariamente el mismo que nuestros padres han entendido, y muchas veces se hace difícil explicar conceptos sin entender el uno y el otro. Por eso es que cuando yo digo que es entender las lenguas culturalmente, con la edad, con el día de hoy, es importante entender eso para poder llegar al punto que uno puede entender que cuando alguien está preguntando sobre los magos, sobre los magos, está hablando del punto de vista, de la perspectiva que no entienden el concepto de esa palabra fuera del entendimiento que esa palabra tiene algo que ver con magia, tiene algo que ver con vudú, tiene algo que ver con santería y todas estas cosas que le hemos puesto, ay, me corregí yo sola, que le hemos puesto tonalidades negativas, pero por eso es que es importante entender la lengua. I was also asked, what are the biggest changes you have seen, are seeing, or anticipate seeing in this faith community compared to other periods? Language. I think, and I'm at fault here gravely, and I have to say I only can speak from my church, my community of faith, my little box. So remember that I'm only speaking the box name Manantial de Gracia. But in our little box, we've come to the realization that language has become such an important thing, I have 5 minutes, that it's become such a big thing that has the potential to separate us, que la lengua se ha convertido en una cosa tan importante y tan grave que tiene la capacidad de separarnos. But we have to find ways to let it unify us because we are a bridge generation. We're a bridge between the people who came before us who don't speak the language, un puente entre las personas que llegaron antes que nosotros, que no hablan este idioma de la manera que nosotros lo hablamos, pero también un puente a la gente que todavía está llegando. We're still also a bridge to the people who are still arriving. So we can't be a Spanish-speaking congregation and be a congregation to someone like me. No podemos ser una congregación de habla español y olvidarnos de la gente que son como yo. But we also can't be an English-speaking congregation and forget about people who came like my mother or who are still coming. Tampoco podemos ser una congregación de habla inglés y olvidarnos de la gente como mi mamá que llegaron o la gente como mis tías que no han llegado todavía, pero quizás llegan en otra ocasión. Ahora, pero ahí hay otros niveles de lengua. There are other levels of language. Music, instruments, música, instrumento, technology. technology becomes a different language that we don't all speak, but we all have to find a way to maneuver into. I have one quick video that I'll share with you, and I'll explain the story very quickly. Le voy a enseñar un video bien cortito, y entonces les explico la circunstancia. Because all I have inside of me, inside my heart, needs more of you, God. Now, this is a child. The reason why I'm sharing this video, la razón que yo estoy enseñándole este video, is it's because oftentimes we don't realize that children pick up on nuances that we don't realize they notice. This is a child whose parents were not churched, who started to come to church visiting slowly. La familia empezó a llegar a la iglesia visitando poco en poco. And she has learned what worship looks like in the context of our little box, en el contexto de nuestra cajita pequeña. What happens? ¿Qué pasa cuando pasa eso? She's learning what worship can look like. We've taken the context of it has to look this way or that way out of the box. We've unpackaged it a little bit. That doesn't mean that the only way to worship is my way. That means it doesn't have to be my way, but it can be some other way. Eso quiere decir que la manera de en realidad adorar a Dios no tiene que ser la manera que mi mamá lo aprendió o la manera que él lo está aprendiendo, pero puede que sea. So we're opening ourselves up to the potential. So what I would suggest to people who are looking at Latino ministry is to look at it as potential. Potential for yourself as much as for the Latino community. Que cuando la gente esté pensando en abrir iglesias en nuestras comunidades, que entiendan que esto es un proceso, que esto es un concepto de cómo puede ser, pero no es la manera tuya o la manera mía. Tiene que ser una unión entre las dos cosas. It has to be a merging of both. It can't be the way you worship versus the way I worship. It's got to be a give and take. So thank you.
Muchas gracias, Elibeth. Y ahora terminamos con el pastor Ross Carter.
Boa noite.
Boa noite.
Good night. Vou começar com um texto bíblico. I will not start with a biblical text. I'm sorry for my other panelists here. Eu vou começar com uma frase muito conhecida de Nietzsche. A very well-known statement by Nietzsche. Life without music would be a mistake. A vida sem música seria um engano. Para começar então a minha parte, eu estava my part. I would like to play a music before. I cannot do anything without music. Não posso fazer nada sem música. Thank you. O que eu gostaria de trazer nessa noite. Do I need to translate into English as well? Okay. What I'd like to bring to this evening here, it's a kind of a more sociological and philosophical foundation for the Latino church in this context. What I'd like to o que eu gostaria de trazer mais seria a questão de uma análise um pouco mais sociológica e filosófica da igreja latino-americana no contexto norte-americano. In order to do that, I rely a lot in a very well-known book by Peter Berg, The Social Construction of Reality. E para fazer isso, eu me apoio bastante numa obra conhecida, que já se torna até um clássico, Construção Social da Realidade. What is Social Construction of Reality? O que é essa construção social da realidade? É quando a realidade é construída não individualmente. It's when reality is not an individual construction. The understanding of this is, in order to construct a real, something real, we need to share, we need to contribute. A fim de construir uma realidade social, é preciso que haja interação. É mais do que ser somente uma análise objetiva ou meramente subjetiva, é ser intersubjetivo. In order to construct social reality, we request, it's requested more than just an objective view or a mere subjective vision of everything. We need what we call the intersubjectivity. E como nós definiríamos essa intersubjetividade? How can we understand this intersubjectivity? É quando nós reconhecemos que existe um sujeito aqui e um sujeito lá. It's when we recognize there is a subject here and not an object there, but another subject. Porque se nós fizéssemos uma construção puramente sujeito-objeto, nós estaríamos construindo uma coisa e não uma sociedade. Because if we had this kind of object-subject or subject-object, instead of constructing a society, community, would be constructing a thing. And eu acredito que a igreja não é uma coisa. And I believe that church is not one thing. Eu acredito que a igreja é verdadeiramente, espiritualmente, metafisicamente, o corpo de Cristo. Porque, because I believe that the church is truly, spiritually or metaphysically speaking, the true body of Christ. Se a igreja é um verdadeiro corpo de Cristo, espiritualmente ou metafisicamente, então não é feito de algo, mas é feito de alguém. Therefore, if the church is the true body of Christ, instead of being made of things, it is made of real people. And we have to acknowledge, respect, and honor everybody. E por isso nós temos que aprender a honrar, respeitar a todos que estão dentro da igreja, the body of Christ, o corpo de Cristo. O verso base para isso, the biblical verse that I could use here, is the very well-known text from Galatians, where Paul says, there's no Jew, there's no Greek, no male, no female, no slave, no free man. No free people. All is one in Christ. Porque em Cristo Jesus não há judeu, não há grego, não há escravo, não há livre, não há homem, não há mulher, todos são um em Cristo. Paulo está falando de construir uma nova realidade social para aquelas pessoas. Paul was speaking about constructing a new reality for that people. something new. Paulo estava falando sobre construir algo que verdadeiramente era novo para aquelas pessoas. Construir uma nova identidade. To construct a new identity. What is good and bad at the same time. Construir uma nova identidade é sempre algo positivo como negativo, bom como mal. Por quê? É bom porque quando se constrói uma identidade, nós criamos um sentido de pertencência, se eu posso usar essa expressão assim em português. It's good because when we create a new identity, we have this feeling that we really belong to that place. But the other side, if I stress too much this new identity, I might become so exclusivist that I deny the other. E o lado negativo é que se eu enfatizo demais essa nova identidade que foi criada, então eu também posso começar a rejeitar os que não se parecem comigo. Then I can reject everybody that does not look just like me. Aí o problema com essa nova identidade que foi construída, and the problem with this new identity is, instead of being on this idea of subject, it becomes subject and object. E o problema que pode trazer com essa nova identidade é que ao invés de manter a ideia de subjetivo, sujeito, pode começar a criar a ideia de sujeito, objeto. E se esquece da ideia de intersubjetividade. Nas igrejas que eu tenho atuado, in the churches that I have been working, presently I've been working with two churches, one in Worcester and one in New Bedford. Presentemente eu tenho trabalhado com duas igrejas, uma em Worcester e outra em New Bedford. Both churches are immigrant churches. As duas igrejas são imigrantes, but they are not the same. Both speak Portuguese, the main language. Ambas igrejas falam a mesma língua, português. Mas mesmo assim não são iguais. Cada uma tem uma identidade. Although both churches speak the same language, Portuguese, they are not the same church. They are not equal. They are different. They have their own identity. A igreja em Worcester é uma igreja brasileira. The church in Worcester is a Brazilian church. Mas a igreja em New Bedford é uma igreja multiétnica. In New Bedford is a multi-ethnic church. Everybody speaks Portuguese, but we have people from Portugal, Azores, Cape Verde, and Brazil. So it's a more diverse church. New Bedford, Worcester, Portuguese, Brazilians. Então a igreja em New Bedford ela é formada por brasileiros, cabo-verdianos, açorianos e portugueses. But that's not the only reason why each church has its own identity. Mas essa não é a única razão porque cada igreja tem a sua própria identidade. Porque é interessante mesmo que estejamos no mesmo estado, separados por 70 milhas. Because even though we are in the same state, Massachusetts, separated by 70 miles from each other, cada cidade tem a sua maneira de ser. Each city has its own way of expressing the way of living in that city. E por isso, construir uma identidade quando você tem, quando você está inserido num contexto de tantas diferenças, não é fácil. E por isso, and therefore, to construct a reality when you have so much difference, not diversity, but difference, is not easy. It's a hard task. E por isso que a gente tem que sempre aprender, and for this reason we have always to learn, that in order to build, to construct reality, after that, there is another writer that I like very much, his book, as he's writing, his name is James Carey. It's not Jim Carey, okay? It's James. James Carey, he says in a book that I like very much as well, Communication as Culture. Nesse livro de James Carey, Comunicação como Cultura, ele fala que é preciso quatro coisas quando se constrói uma realidade. In this book, he says that we have four things when we construct a reality, a social reality. First, it's construction itself. What I'm going to call here, in order to make it mnemonic strategy. Construction, I'm going to call it form. Quando nós construímos uma realidade, nós estamos formando, é dar a forma a essa realidade. After construction has been done, we have to maintain this reality. This maintenance I would call conformation. Depois de formarmos uma realidade, nós precisamos de aprender a como nos conformar com essa realidade. O que também não é uma tarefa muito fácil. It's not an easy task, anyway, to conform. Mas conformar não significa aceitar para sempre como foi construído. But conform doesn't mean to accept that as the only model and the only way and nothing can be done. Nós temos que sempre voltar e fazermos reparos. We have to repair. Or we have to reform. All formed, conformed reality, social reality, has to be reformed. Sem construção social que passa por uma formação, uma conformação, tem que sempre ter uma reforma. Se não houver reforma, a construção que foi realizada se enrijece, se petrifica e vira monumento. All construction that was made, all formation and conformation, if we do not have a reformation, it's going to be like a petrification and becomes a monument and is doomed to be like, I like Nietzsche, if you don't like, I'm sorry. But then it's going to be up to come back with a hammer and destroy it. I believe that everything that is so petrified, that has no more life, because it did not accept reformation, we are a reformed church, somehow.
Pastor.
5 minutes. If we do not accept this reformation, we are going to be petrified, and then somebody will come with a hammer and will destroy it. To avoid destruction from this social reality, para evitar a destruição dessa construção, dessa realidade que foi construída, para evitar que alguém venha com um martelo e destrua, é preciso que então haja formação, sim, conformação, sim, reforma, sim, mas transformação. In order to avoid this destruction, we hope nobody will come with the hammer and destroy what we have constructed. So we need, yes, we need formation, we need conformation, we need reformation, but we need transformation. Reformation has to lead inevitably to transformation. In the context que eu vivo, in the context that I express my ministry, I try to see things as I'm trying to say. To bring everybody in the context and to honor everybody. And no contexto que eu vivo, eu gosto de apreciar e respeitar a cada pessoa que está ali dentro. E eu vou finalizar com um exemplo. And I'm going to finish with this example. No ano passado, na passagem do ano, 2013 para 2014, at the end of the year 2013-2014, we have this celebration. We come to church from 10 to midnight, and we pray and worship, we sing, we play, and then after that we have like a New Year's dinner. And last year I tried to make it differently. Instead of service, worship, and dinner, I thought maybe dinner first, and then service and worship. E no ano passado eu pensei, talvez em vez de fazer o culto e depois o jantar, eu pensei, vamos mudar a ordem. E eu dei aquela sugestão para a igreja. Todos aceitaram, gostaram da ideia, não sei por quê. Everybody liked the idea. I don't know why, but they like it. But one person. Menos uma pessoa. E eu perguntei, por quê? And I asked, why? She said, I have to work. If you do dinner first, I will miss the dinner. And I said, what would be more important, dinner or service now? But then I saw that she said she would miss dinner, and dinner means worship as well. We see in the Bible that the highest point of celebration is the Lord's Supper, is when we eat together. So she can miss part of singings and words, but she cannot miss the fellowship at the table, because that's the moment when we interact. Eu pensei, então, bom, qual seria mais importante, perder parte do culto ou perder o jantar para essa irmã? E eu pensei, bom, já que a parte alta do culto também tem a ceia do Senhor, eu pensei, o jantar também é uma celebração. Porque Cristo é o Senhor não somente da mesa da ceia, mas é o Senhor da nossa mesa de comer todos os dias. E por causa dessa única pessoa, eu voltei para a igreja e falei assim, a irmã não pode estar na hora do jantar, então vamos fazer como nós temos o costume para ela poder participar do jantar. Then I said, this sister cannot take part of this moment, so we are going to do it the same way that we have been done so far because of one person. We could say, well, majority wins, but I decided to teach, when you construct a social reality, everybody is important. And we have to learn to appreciate one over many. God bless you. Amen.
Cuando se nos da un gran regalo, a veces no hay palabras que se pueden dar para agradecer. Entonces yo me siento que hemos obtenido un gran obsequio por parte de nuestros tres panelistas, que estamos quizá digiriendo y trabajando las palabras en nuestro corazón y en nuestra mente. Y claro, les otorgué un poquito más de tiempo porque el regalo era magnífico. Entonces, quiero honrar el tiempo de nuestra reunión y honrar que tenemos también un compartir en mesa y en comida. Y entonces vamos a dejar nuestros comentarios, nuestras preguntas para hacerlo en comunión afuera con nuestro compartir. Pero sí les invito a que se queden con nosotros, que traigan sus preguntas, que traigan sus inquietudes, que haya más conversación a seguido afuera de las puertas. Y también pues les vuelvo a recordar que si les gustó este panel, que vengan la semana que viene, el martes, porque va a estar igual de bueno. So I guess what I was saying, I'll summarize in English, is that when you're given a great gift, you're sometimes left speechless. You have this amazing gift in your hands and you don't know what to do with it. And I feel like we have gotten a superb gift from all three panelists. And to both honor the time limit that we are at 7:30 already, and also to honor the time that we need to digest in our hearts and in our minds what we've been given. We're going to close here, but if you could bring your questions and conversations to each other and to the panelists outside when we will be sharing in a meal, in a light meal, light refreshments, then you're welcome to do so. And also that if you enjoy what you heard tonight and you thought that this fed you and gave you something to take back to your communities and take back to your own theological questioning and understanding, then come back next week because it's going to be just as good. This same night, Tuesday night, 6:15, Orlando and Rose Costa's lecture with Dr. Orlando Espín giving his lecture. And it's free of charge. Bring your communities if you feel that they want to come up the hill and spend a nice autumn evening here at the Ann Arbor Newton campus. We'd love to have you. So thank you. Thank you so much. Mil gracias a todos ustedes. Mucho obrigado to all of you for what you've given us. And thank you for joining us. And please join us for some refreshments.
Just one more thing, please. I'm sorry. I cannot forget this. I was already forgetting. I was graduated here in 2005. And Bob Pasmin was my first advisor. Thank you.
Thank you. Vamos a cerrar antes de pasar a los refrigerios. Carla Díaz nuevamente nos va a dirigir en oración para cerrar nuestra reunión en oración. We're going to close with prayer again, led by our student Carla.
A gente vai cantar hino que fala muito ao meu coração. Em Hebreus 12, fala que Jesus é o autor da nossa fé. In Hebrews 12, says that Jesus is the author of our faith. If we are Christians, right? Just in case, let's be inclusive. That's what we learn now at Andover Newton. Yay. So, yeah, Jesus is the author of my faith. And I hope that you and you and you, one day, even if we don't see each other anymore here, we get to meet together and hold hands one day. Pai, eu queria tanto ver o meu Senhor descer, vindo me encontrar. Eu posso até imaginar a refulgente glória do Senhor Jesus, transpondo as brancas nuvens no mais puro azul, onde nem sul nem norte existirá. E em meio a lágrimas, sorrisos de alegria e de prazer, eu que era cego agora posso ver, contemplar enfim. Por isso eu canto glória, glória, glória ao autor da minha fé, glória, glória.
ao autor da minha fé. Oh, Pai, eu queria tanto, tanto ouvir o som que vai abrir o encontro triunfal. Rever amigos que um dia em Cristo foram feitos meus irmãos. Agora sim podemos dar as mãos, pois temos todos somente um só Senhor. E eis o consolo que envolve a minha vida, o meu Senhor Jesus, que foi morto, sim, naquela cruz. Voltará, voltará, enfim. Por isso eu canto glórias, glórias, glórias ao autor da minha fé. Glória, glória ao autor da minha fé. Glória ao Senhor, glória ao Senhor, glória ao Senhor, autor da minha fé. Glória ao Senhor, glória ao Senhor, autor da minha fé. Amém. Muito obrigada por ser porque o Senhor é autor da nossa fé. Muito obrigada. Te damos graças porque nós temos essa fé, porque temos essa esperança, porque sabemos que se morremos agora, temos esperança de um Deus que vai nos encontrar. Temos esperança de encontrar com o Senhor. Thank you for the faith of which you are the author. Thank you for the hope we have. Thank you because we know that if we die right now, we know that we're going to go and see you face to face. Tão bom saber que o Senhor cuida do nosso coração e alivia na hora da dor. O Senhor nos dá amigos, o Senhor nos dá comunhão verdadeira. Obrigada por esses pastores queridos que nos ensinaram tanto nesse momento. Abençoa a vida deles e o ministério deles. Thank you, Lord, for all you have given to us. And I thank you for each of these pastors, these ministers, that gave us so much, that we learned so much with them in so little time. Bless their lives and their ministry. I want to bring them and us into your hands so you can embrace us all. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay. Food. Food. There was a joke. There was a seminarian joke. I'm hungry. No, I'm not hungry. Thank you.
sí, el talento de la música.
El talento de la música.